So, Sandro Mereghetti. Sandro, are you ready?
Yes. I'm sharing the screen now, and you should see the presentation.
Okay, yes, now yes.
Okay, so first, let me thank you, the organizer, for inviting me to this. I was asked to talk about fast radio burst, but actually, I'm not an expert at all on fast radio bursts. I will mostly talk about the connection between fast radio bursts and magnetars, because I think this is very interesting for two reasons. First of all, we know what magnetars are. They are neutron stars powered by magnetic energy. On the other hand, fast radio bursts are still a complete mystery. So, having found a connection between these two classes of objects is very interesting, I believe. And also because this connection makes fast radio bursts also very relevant for a mission like Hermes. So, what are fast radio bursts? Fast radio bursts are very short pulses seen in the radio band. They last a few milliseconds. They have a large dispersion. That means that radiation of lower frequencies arrives with a delay. This is not an intrinsic property of the source, it's just a propagation effect, and depends on how much plasma is between us and the source. And if one knows the distribution of electrons along the line of sight, the dispersion measure gives you a way of estimating the distance of the sources. This is something that has been done traditionally, for instance, with radio pulsars in our galaxy. And all these fast radio bursts have dispersion measures that are larger than the ones that you would expect for the effect of the plasma in our galaxy, and this tells us that these sources are extragalactic. This indeed has been confirmed by the few FRBs that have been localized very precisely in the sky and for which host galaxies have been found. Most of the fast radio bursts are just single-shot events, but there is a growing sample of events that are seen to repeat, and among them there are a few, two up to now, that also show periodicity in their activities. The rate of fast radio burst is very large, but basically the conclusion is that up to now we don't have a clear idea of what these sources are, except that they are extragalactic objects. Many models have been proposed involving many different kinds of objects, from compact objects to AGNs to more exotic things like cosmic strings or even extraterrestrial civilization. And probably the only thing that all these models have in common is that none of them is the correct one. On the other hand, we know reasonably well what the magnetars are. Magnetars are a small subset of neutron stars that are powered by magnetic energy. You see their position by the red points in these PP dot diagrams, and contrary to the majority of radio pulsars that we know, they are not powered by rotational energy losses. What is relevant for us today is that most magnetars are transient objects. This means that they spend most of the time in a quiescent state, but from time to time they start to emit bursts of hard X-rays with a duration of hundreds of milliseconds typically. And these bursts can be emitted either in a sporadic way or in groups of many hundreds of births within a small time period. Sometimes these magnetars also meet so-called giant flares that are even more energetic than the normal bursts. And up to now, only three giant flares have been seen from magnetars. The fact that most magnetars are transient tell us that there are in the galaxy many more magnetars that we still have to discover. We have seen in recent years then that when there are good satellites able to cover a wide fraction of the sky, typically we discover a new magnetar every year. So this is very relevant for Hermes. So why we think that there should be a link between magnetars and fast radio bursts? There are several reasons. First of all, we know that fast radio bursts are very short events, and this gives you immediately some constraint on their size. On the other hand, we know their distance scale, so we know that the energy implied in this phenomena is very large. So you need some source, some engine that allows you to have a large energy in a limited amount of space, and compact objects are of course a candidate for this. From equipartition considerations, one also derives from the fast radio bursts magnetic fields that are of the order of those of neutron stars. Fast radio bursts show high degree of polarization, and also this is something that points toward something related to magnetic fields. And finally, another important point is that the fact that we see many fast radio bursts that are repeating is telling us that we need something that is not disrupted when the burst occurs. And so in this respect, again, magnetars are very good candidates. So up to now, there were all these, let's say, theoretical arguments, very solid, and many models were developed to explain the fast radio burst that involved magnetars in some way. But a real link based on observation was missing, and this has been found only recently, last April, with the observation of this magnetar called SGR 1935. That represents this first observational evidence that indeed these classes of sources are connected. So SGR 1935 is a magnetar, is a rather well-known magnetar in our galaxy. You see its position in this map. It is in the galactic plane toward the galactic bulge. It is a rather normal magnetar. It has a spin period of about 3 seconds. You see the light curves that show you the modulation due to the neutron star rotation in this plot. As it happens for many galactic magnetars, is very likely associated to a supernova remnant, and you see the radio and X-ray images of the supernova remnant in this plot. This magnetar became active, very active actually, in April this year. What is plotted here is the number of bursts per day as a function of time. And you see that starting in April, the rate of bursts from this object started to increase very significantly. And so for these reasons, many X-ray and gamma ray satellites started to observe this object, because indeed magnetars are very interesting to observe when they are active and emitting bursts. The majority of the burst was emitted on April 27. The following day, the Swift X-ray telescope detected this dust scattering ring, and we could use the apparent angular expansion of this feature to derive a distance to the magnet. Is it a distance that is still quite large uncertainties, but I think it is important because it is for this particular source the first distance estimate that does not depend on assuming a real association with a supernova remnant. But I'm not talking about this and this today. I go to the burst that occurred the following day on April 28. We were observing this magnetar with integral. On integral, we have a system to automatically detect in real time gamma ray bursts, the so-called integral burst alert system. And of course, this software is also effective in detecting soft gamma ray repeaters and magnetars bursts. And indeed, this burst was immediately detected and immediately localized with a few arc minutes accuracy and identified with SGR 1935. And an alert was automatically sent over the internet to communicate this discovery. A few hours later, an astronomer telegram announced that the Chime radio telescope in Canada detected a very bright pulse of radio waves in the 400 to 800 megahertz band and located it with a precision about 1 degree at the position of 1935. And a few hours later, another astronomer telegram confirmed the independent detection of this fast burst of radio emission. This was done with the STER 2 radio telescopes in the United States. They had a worse location accuracy, but the time of the event was exactly the same of the ones seen by the Chime radio telescope and by the integral satellite in X-rays. So there is no doubt at all that all these events are related and coming from the same source, that is a magnetar in our galaxy. As you see from these plots, reporting the radio discoveries that were done at different frequencies, because the STER 2 was at higher frequency, it was at 1.4 gigahertz, the pulses are very similar to fast radio bursts. Even in this case, they came from a source in our galaxy. What is really remarkable about this event is the huge fluence in the radio band. You see that we are talking of a fluence of mega Jansky. So this means that for a few milliseconds, this burst was indeed an extremely bright radio source, much brighter than any pulse of radiation seen, for instance, during the giant pulses from radio pulsars. It was more than three orders of magnitude brighter than that. The energy involved in the radio emission was of the order of 10 to the 35, 10 to the 36 erg. Remember that we know the distance of the source, so we are quite confident on the energetic of this event. So why is this important? Because this kind of energy is, in a sense, intermediate between the energies that we see in radio pulses from galactic objects, and it is not far from the energies involved in the less energetic fast radio bursts. Of course, fast radio bursts, being cosmological distances, typically involve much larger energies, but the ones that are closer to us, for which we have a redshift determination, and so we know that, for instance, they are at about 150 megaparsecs, the faintest of them are just a factor about 40 more energetic than this event that we saw from a galactic source. So this event, besides showing that magnetars can produce something very similar to a fast radio burst, is also bridging the energetic gap between these galactic objects and the fast radio bursts. The event was also seen by a few other X-ray and gamma ray satellites, Agile, Conuswind, and InSight, the Chinese satellite. More or less, they gave all consistent results. In the following, I will concentrate on the results that we obtained using Integral. And so I start by showing you the light curves, measure this integral in the hard X-ray band. It is shown in the blue, with the blue line, and is compared to the time of arrival of the two radio pulses, because you remember that the two radio pulses are separated by about 30 milliseconds. It is interesting to see that also the X-ray light curves has narrow spikes that show a separation between themselves of about 30 milliseconds. So it is tempting to associate these spikes with the radio emission. And if we do so, then we see that the X-rays in the spikes are delayed by about 6 milliseconds compared to the radio spikes. On the other hand, the pulse in X-rays was rather longer. It lasted about 700 milliseconds, and it started well before the radio emission. We are sure that this part of the burst at the beginning of the light curve is indeed due to the magnetar, because Integral is an imaging instrument, and so we can confirm that this emission is not a background variation, but was indeed associated to the magnetar, because we see it in the images. Let me remark also that the fact that these events have such a narrow time structure is very relevant for Hermes, because for instance, what limits this kind of study that we could do with Integral was not the effective area or the counting statistics, but the dead times. So we could not do smaller time beams just because of dead time effects. And I think that Hermes, having its effective area distributed over many satellites, will not suffer of this kind of problem. So it will be possible to study really the fine structure of the time variability in events of this kind. That is very important, because if you want to correlate with the radio emission, for instance, that has a pulse width that are smaller than 1 millisecond, this is very important. Going now to the spectrum of this burst, the spectrum was well described as it typically happens for a magnetar burst by an exponentially cutoff power law. What is interesting is that by making spectra as a function of time, we see evidence that the spectrum became harder as a function of time. The peak energy increased from about 30 to more than 100 keV. What about the energetic of this event? From the point of view of the X-ray energy, was not particularly bright. You see in this plot a sample of bursts from this magnetar plotted in which we plot the fluence and the peak energy. So you see that the fluence of this event was not particularly bright compared to other events from the same source. On the other hand, its spectrum was significantly harder than typical values observed before. Definitely, this event was not a giant flare. was a rather typical burst. So now, of course, the question that arises is why radio emission had been detected only from this magnetar, and why only from this particular burst? There have been radio telescopes able to detect similar events and covering the region of skies containing magnetars operating since several years, but this is the only event of this kind that was detected up to now. So first of all, we notice that there is nothing really special in this magnetar. It has typical values compared to the other magnetars that we know. There is nothing special about it. Some papers mention that this magnetar is particularly active. I do not agree with that. Indeed, this magnetar was discovered in 2014. Since then, it had four or five outbursts, but this object has been quiescent for decades before that. So I don't think it's really more active than other magnetars that we know about. Why only this burst? The only unusual thing, I think, is its particularly hard spectrum compared to other bursts. The light curve also could be slightly different because it shows possibly more structure than a typical light curves from SGR bursts. We also noticed that this magnetar had the most spasmodic activity actually the day before, and no radio emission was observed, while the radio pulse was observed in this burst that occurred the following day while the source was becoming less active in X-rays. So there is really no clear reason to associate the radio emission to this specific burst.
Sandro, 2 minutes.
Yes. This plot shows X-ray fluence versus radio fluence, and this is the position of the April 28 burst. It had a ratio of radio to X-ray fluence of a few times to the minus 5, and it is interesting to compare it with other events from magnetars, for instance, the giant flare that occurred in another magnetar in 2004, for which we have radio upper limits that imply a ratio of radio to X-ray fluence that is orders of magnitude smaller than the event from SGR 1935. On the other hand, we have also limits on other X-rays observation of fast radio bursts that are not very constraining, but we have radio upper limits on magnetar bursts that imply that there is a large range of the ratio between radio and X-ray emission. So what are the kind of models that can explain these events? The models for FRBs that involve magnetars can be broadly divided into two categories. Let's call them pulsar-like, that involve emission in the close to the neutron star, in the magnetosphere, and other models instead that indeed do not rely necessarily on a magnetar, but just on some central engine able to produce a relativistic jet. And in this kind of GRB-like models, the radio and X-ray emission is supposed to take place in the relativistic shocks between the ejected material and some surrounding medium. Most of these models were actually developed before the recent results, and they were tailored about the energetics that we usually see associated to giant flares, not to normal bursts like the one of last April. These pulsar-like models are attractive, in my opinion, because we believe that at least the X-ray and gamma rays of the bursts indeed takes place in the magnetosphere. So I think that these kind of models are in a sense more straightforward because they involve a single production site. On the other hand, it is true that after 50 years, we do not know what produces radio emission in radio pulses. So it is even more complicated here in the case of FRBs. The other class of models involves some ejection relativistic and interaction with circumstellar material that could be either the stellar wind, the pulsar wind emitted before, or the ejecta of previous explosions. And these kind of models are not dependent necessarily on a magnetar as a central energy source. So I will conclude here just by saying once more that now we have this evidence for this connection that was suspected since a long time, but now we have a solid basis. I think that the problem of what the FRBs are is not solved, but definitely I think that these results strongly support all the models that involve magnetars. And I think that this also implies a very interesting and promising scientific case that will be very useful to investigate with Hermes. Thank you.